It's time to do a 2024 college football tier list. This is going to be a little bit of a different video on this channel. The stuff we usually tackle is a little bit more higher concept, just thoughts about things like a group of five playoff or why I think the 4-team playoff is perfect or maybe why Colorado had their turnaround under Deion, stuff like that. This one is just a little bit more fun. We're going to do a tier list of just the power five. So if you're a group of five guy, sorry to disappoint you, but it just simplifies things to have only categories that Power 5 teams will fit into. It just makes it a lot nicer. So without further ado, let's get into it. So first thing we're going to take a look at is what our tiers are exactly. You see the team bank over there on the right side. 70 teams that qualify as Power 5, kind of going with the old structure. I know it's not really a Power 5 anymore. Oregon State and Washington State, the only two members of the Pac-12 for this season, but they have Power 5 infrastructure still. So I've included them with everybody else. SMU is the one technical group of five team that joined the fray this year. And looking at the tiers, we've got title favorites. So these are going to be the teams at the top that, I'm pretty self-explanatory, are favored to win the title. We got our top contenders, teams that I think could challenge the title favorites, maybe go on a bit of a Cinderella run and win the title themselves. In the playoff hunt, you've got to reconsider what that tier means. There's going to be a 12-team playoff, not a 4-team playoff. So that's going to be a little bit more inclusive than it otherwise would have been. Bowl season, which is teams that I think have bowl season to look forward to, are probably going to make a bowl game. We've got the below mid, sadly, tier, because it's sad when a team's below mid. And then we have the bad tier, teams that just don't have a lot going their way that I anticipate to be pretty terrible. So let's get in. We're going to start from the top because that's probably going to be most commonly agreed upon teams in that tier. So starting off in the title favorites tier, this tier is pretty exclusive. I think only four teams belong in this tier, and that's because it's the four teams I would have at the top of the national title odds right now: Georgia, Oregon, Texas, and Ohio State. The way these teams have taken elite rosters and built upon them in this offseason has been pretty incredible to watch, and a lot of it has been a direct result of power programs like Alabama and Washington having their roster sort of picked apart. These teams have benefited from that. And just from NIL and the transfer portal in general, Ohio State very publicly using millions of dollars in NIL to field an elite roster. Georgia already had an elite roster. We already know what they're capable of. Oregon with really high profile additions through the portal as well. And the Longhorns just continue to reload. Steve Sarkisian, notably the only head coach left from the four playoff teams that made it last year, which I think is really interesting. If I'm being honest with myself, you could take Georgia and Ohio State and put them in a tier of their own above the title favorites tier. Maybe they're in the title favorites tier, and then Texas and Oregon are in the title sub-favorites. I'm not sure what I would call that category, but I do think Georgia and Ohio State are kind of on another level. If I had to put some money on it right now and it was Georgia and Ohio State versus the field, I would take Georgia and Ohio State to win the national title, one of those two. It feels like that is almost inevitable this year, but Oregon and Texas, still elite rosters, still title favorites. I would consider them among the top four favorites. So we go to the second tier, we get a little bit more inclusive here. We're in the top contenders, teams that I think could be a thorn in the side of the title favorites, maybe knock them off, maybe be a sleeper that could make a run, sort of like a Washington did last year where they were, you know, a game away from winning the national title. In the top contenders tier, Ole Miss, another team that used the portal to field a near elite roster. Time will tell with Ole Miss. What makes me uncomfortable with the Rebels is what percentage of their roster is built through the portal, and it's a high percentage, which means we're just going to be dealing with a little bit more variability in the performance there. Alabama, what on earth is Alabama football going to look like? We're not even going to know till the transfer portal reopens and Kalen DeBoer has a chance to go hunting, but he just landed a nice five-star wide receiver recruit that dropped this week. So I have faith that Alabama's not just going to fall off the face of the earth. I think they'll still be very relevant. Oklahoma State's a team that returns a lot of production, and I trust Gundy and company to roll out a contending squad in a weaker Big 12. I mean, they excelled in a Big 12 that had Texas and Oklahoma, and now this year, those obstacles are removed and replaced with teams that, if anything, are just able to replicate what Oklahoma State does well. You look at a team like Utah or a team like Arizona, Oklahoma State kind of set the blueprint for what those teams have been able to do. So I really like the Cowboys' chances in the Big 12, and that's why the only other Big 12 team up there is Kansas State, because of Klieman and his ability to elevate his team to the same degree. He's just been excellent for Kansas State. And the fact that they were able to win the Big 12 a couple years ago was a sure sign, just made a tongue twister for myself, that they'll be a contender in the Big 12 this year. Among the other teams in the list, we have Missouri. Missouri returns a lot of what made them successful this year, and they are just doing exactly what they did last offseason. There's Michigan. Jim Harbaugh's officially gone, so I can say with confidence that I've got the Wolverines solidly in this tier. It's going to be interesting. If they replace it with Sharon Moore, there's a chance for more immediate success. My question for the Wolverines is, what do you prioritize, short-term or long-term success? By the time this video comes out, though, they may have made a decision on that. There's Penn State. The Nittany Lions and James Franklin have proven they're going to be in this tier every year, and they have not been able to beat teams in the title favorites tier and really many other top contenders in the same tier as them. They are just kind of the epitome of a great but not good enough kind of team. And then you've got Florida State, LSU, and Notre Dame. Trust in Mike Norvell, his ability to build a roster through the portal and contend in a weaker ACC compared to the Big Ten and SEC. That's why Florida State appears there as the lone ACC team. LSU, another SEC team, obviously. Brian Kelly, he's always shown that he's able to build a roster as he goes. And there was a lot of inconsistencies in year one and year two of LSU. Don't get it twisted. So I think that he's definitely going to have to answer some questions. And losing Mike Denbrock to Notre Dame, who also appears on this list, I think is pretty significant. I think Notre Dame can do big things this year. And they're a team that I would consider right now for that fifth spot behind the four contenders. But I think there's a couple teams you could argue to get in there. But that's kind of where I stand on those guys for now. So we're into the next tier, the in the playoff hunt tier. Like I said earlier in the video, you got to remember it's a 12-team playoff now, which means you're going to have a little bit wider of a net that is being cast, a little bit more inclusion there. So you've got a couple Big 12 teams like Utah, Kyle Whittingham and company, just a model of consistency, and they can beat up on those other Big 12 teams, and they're bound to be healthier this year than they were last year. Arizona's a tricky one because I do think the Wildcats lost a lot, but I like some of the things that have been happening. Brent Brennan isn't my favorite hire in the world, but he's getting Dino Babers to come on his staff as a coordinator, which I think is phenomenal. T-Mac and Noah Fafita, they're coming back as well. So there's a lot to like, but also a little bit to be scared about as well. And the Jayhawks, I mean, I just don't see how you can't have them on here with the job Lance Leipold has done and the just linear improvement that they have had at Kansas year to year has been really impressive to watch. So I think that that's a team that's got to be included in this tier. If you keep going, you look at teams in the ACC like Clemson, North Carolina, Louisville, Miami, NC State. I don't think there's going to be much pushback on Clemson. People pretty much know what they are, a team that refuses to use the portal that would give them an extra edge, but still an excellent team. Mac Brown in North Carolina, they've been pretty consistent as long as he's been the coach, a good but not great team that, you know, could have a sneaky chance. Louisville, I think Louisville's not going to see insane linear improvement like I was just talking about with Kansas in year two. I think that they're relying heavily on the portal again, number one portal class again. The percentage of their roster that is made up of portal players, very high. And for that reason, I think there's high variability with the success that Louisville can have. So don't be surprised if they come out and only win like 7 or 8 games this year. But I do have them, it's in the playoff hunt. I think that's a very real possibility. NC State, the Wolfpack, they have been a very quiet team, but operating. They're like in the top 5 right now in the portal. Maybe number 6, actually. That might be misinformation. But that's something that Dave Doran doesn't usually do. But it seems like NC State has ponied up and thrown some more money into the NIL fund and really gotten a better roster together. And then there's the Miami Hurricanes. I see Mario Cristobal and I just see Steve Sarkisian 2.0. I think he's very capable of winning in Miami. He's building an elite roster, and he's going to do it. It's only a matter of time. People are saying the same exact stuff about Cristobal this offseason that they said about Sark going into last season, which is, he can recruit, but he can't win. I just think that's silly. So filling in the gaps with some of the teams I didn't talk about, you've got the Iowa Hawkeyes. The Hawkeyes are a team that's been a model of consistency, and their consistency is that they've got an elite defense and just a tragic offense. And they became a parody of themselves last year, and I don't know what it's going to look like with Ferentz launching another search for an offensive coordinator. I think people are going to get hopeful about what can happen, but I don't think the offensive coordinator hire is going to change much. It's going to be a lot of the same, and I think people are going to start to realize that Kirk Ferentz is going to be Kirk Ferentz as long as he's the coach of Iowa, and Iowa fans have to decide whether or not they're okay with that. You've got USC, Miller Moss, thought to be the guy with the Trojans. Lincoln Riley's got a pretty big year 3 for USC. Kind of like a put up or shut up year after a phenomenal year one. Year two was kind of a dumpster fire by the Trojan standards. So he's got to go out and prove he's not the next Clay Helton, really. And Tennessee, the next one. Josh Heupel and the Vols. Tough to read, in my opinion. It was interesting how much the team and the dynamic of their team and offense especially and defense changed from year one to year two. Year one, they had a Swiss cheese defense and an offense that could light up the scoreboard. Year two, offense was very run heavy and very inconsistent, and the defense was the strength. They led the SEC in sacks all year. So for the Volunteers, I really just don't know what to expect or what this team's going to look like. It's going to be interesting to see it shake out more. Maybe Heupel's more comfortable with Ayamaleava. Hopefully I said that kind of right. And maybe Tennessee surprises some people, but that remains to be seen. You've got a team like Wisconsin. I know Luke Fickell can still coach. I still have faith in him. Brent Venables in Oklahoma got a big year three ahead of him. They saw the steady improvement from one to two. And then Texas Tech. I'm drinking the Tech Kool-Aid. They killed it in the portal again. And I think that they'll be a lot healthier. And I just really like Joey McGuire getting another crack at it. All right, here we go. It's time for the bowl season tier. There are just a lot of teams sandwiched in here, so I'll try to go through them rapid fire. With Cal, I like them for a bowl, and I almost put them in the playoff hunt tier, which would have been egregious. I just love Francisco Mendoza. I love the way Wilcox has been stacking talent as of late on Cal. It just feels like they almost overcame a hurdle last year with the way they turned things around, and I think this year could, in a scenario, be Wilcox's best year, but I don't want to speak too soon. Northwestern, I think David Braun can replicate what he did this year. Will it be as successful as last year, like 8 wins successful? I don't know, but I think they'll be very much in the bowl hunt. Same goes for Maryland. Maryland, I had as a preseason top 25 team last year. They ended up being rated about that, but they lost some games they shouldn't have. They lost to Illinois and Northwestern. If they didn't lose those, they would have been a 10-win team with only losses to Michigan, Ohio State, and Penn State. So for the Terrapins, I can't put too much stock and hope in them because it seems like they have kind of a ceiling they can't break through there. Duke's a team that was kind of shafted by the portal, kind of like some of these other teams. But for now, I think maybe they're still a bowl team because it wasn't all bad, and I do like Manny Diaz. So there's some hope to be had there. UCLA, I think, could get lost in the shuffle in the Big Ten. I still have them nabbed as a bowl team. I think Kelly can get something together, but the question remains, will Kelly still be their coach if they just barely scrape by? Auburn's another team. I could totally see the improvement. I nearly ranked them this offseason instead of Ole Miss. Glad I didn't. But you see the vision there for what Hugh Freeze is trying to build, and another solid offseason has me thinking about the potential of them being in the playoff hunt. As we keep going, we got Colorado and the Buffaloes. It just makes sense. I think Prime is going to get the roster just a little bit better, and those margins are going to show up on the field and get them closer to a bowl game, especially with having to play not as many true contenders as they did in the Pac-12. They'll get a slightly softer schedule week to week. UCF, Gus Malzahn, I think they'll continue to improve, return to a bowl game. You've got the Kentucky Wildcats. They've just proven that under Mark Stoops, you pretty much know what you're going to get. You're probably going to get a bowl game. You're probably going to have a lower ceiling, which is just the University of Kentucky football. Arizona State and Kenny Dillingham, I think that they can round out into a bowl team. There's no way they're as unhealthy as they were this last year, and I just trust the boys to do some work, Jaden Rashada, to be a big part of that. SMU, that's another team to keep an eye out for. I almost put them in the playoff hunt, but I think playing Power 5 competition week to week might be different than what we saw last year, which was them beating up on the American. You've got Iowa State and Matt Campbell. I think that they could have a quietly good season. Georgia Tech and Brent Key. I really like what Brent Key is doing at his alma mater. There's Boston College, which, you know, requires no further comment, but they're in the bowl season. I think they've had a quietly good offseason. You've got a team like Rutgers, who coming off of a bowl season, it was an excellent year. There's no reason they can't replicate that. Texas A&M and Mike Elko. I'm not going to put them in the playoff hunt here until I've seen the win stack up, because I feel like we've seen this movie too many times with the Aggies, where you're told about all the successes that are about to happen. It happened under Jimbo so many times. West Virginia, Neil Brown. I think they caught lightning in a bottle last year. I can't see this season being as successful as last year was. Even in a what is perceived as a weaker Big 12, West Virginia avoided Texas and they lost to Oklahoma. So I don't know. I don't necessarily know how many wins, but I think bowl season, same with Virginia Tech and Brent Pry, I think they'll continue to improve. Nebraska and Matt Rule, this has got to be the year, right? It's got to be the year where Huskers fans finally at least get a bowl game, some life, are in a conference race late, something. Syracuse, Fran Brown has been injecting so much talent into Syracuse that I think they can compete right off the bat in the ACC and win enough conference games to get into a bowl game. Then there's Washington. The Huskies, some people might be surprised that they're in this tier, but their roster has been shredded, and it's in a bad way. They lost a bunch of guys to Alabama and elsewhere when DeBoer left, and they didn't get the Arizona guys to come over. So that's a really bad scenario. They're also 10th in Big Ten recruiting right now. It just seems like a recipe for disaster this year for the Huskies. And then last but not least, you have the Oregon State Beavers. I think Trent Bray can win with the talent they've acquired through the portal. They did get shredded as well, but the response they had, they landed some excellent, excellent recruits through the portal that I think will allow them to win because they still have the remnants of a talented roster and they had some big returners. I believe Joshua Gray announcing he would return for the Oregon State Beavers. So some reasons to be optimistic about this year where they're kind of a Mountain West team, but not really. So that last tier was the fullest tier. We get to the next one, the below mid tier. And these are just teams that I think are going to struggle to make a bowl game, and more so than the teams in the tier above them. For some of them, it's a situational thing. For Florida and South Carolina, I have no doubt they could be better than some of the teams in the tier above, but they're just in such a tough conference that it's going to be brutal. Same with a team like Purdue or Minnesota. I think that's going to be an issue as well. For Minnesota, this last season was pretty disheartening with the fall of Ethan Calliope-McManus. He was supposed to be their guy. And you start to wonder what's happening with PJ Fleck and company. When are they going to hit that second gear that they kind of hit in that one year where they competed for that division title? There's a team like Arkansas. I thought about putting the bad tier, but I do think Pittman can turn some things around. But I think Florida and South Carolina ceilings are a little higher than Arkansas this year. There's Pitt. Pat Narduzzi's got to show it to me. He's got to show me that he's willing to change. This offensive coordinator's got to come in. They got to put in some work and actually show a willingness to run a different offense to put themselves in a position to succeed. Wake Forest, I do think Wake Forest can bounce back, and it hurts me to put them in this tier, but it just kind of seems like the game might be catching up to Dave Clawson a little bit. Losing Sam Hartman didn't help. Whenever a program like Wake Forest loses a player of that caliber, and then they also lost Donovan Green to an ACL injury, that it can just really hurt a season, and that's why they look so bad down the stretch in conference play. Washington State, it's a second straight offseason where they're getting shredded by the portal, and I feel like the Jake Dickert experience is starting to sour in Pullman a little bit. As we continue on, TCU, we've seen two completely different teams. All signs point to the latter being the more realistic Sonny Dykes team at TCU, but I could be wrong about them as well. Virginia showed some stuff late in the year with Tony Elliott, won some conference games. It's nice, but you got to see it in a full year body of work. Illinois and Brett Bielema, they're going to be right there. They're going to win some games they shouldn't. They're going to lose some games they shouldn't. It's just the Brett Bielema way. And then last but not least, we have Michigan State with Jonathan Smith. I just think in year one, he's got a lot of work cut out for him. They could win some games. They can turn some positive momentum, but a bowl game doesn't seem super likely. And alas, we've made it to the final tier, the bad tier. Now, you already knew who these teams were going to be because they were the only teams left in the team bank. But you've got Cincinnati. Scott Satterfield's roster is just shredded again for the second straight offseason. And it just seems like he's going to keep sliding. And Satterfield's probably out by midseason, I think. Houston, I do like Willie Fritz being the guy. I do like the fact that he was hired, but in year one, it just seems like he has so much talent to make up for in the Big 12 that Holgorsen was lacking with Houston that it's going to be an issue. At Stanford, Troy Taylor has got to just keep churning, man. They're going to be in the ACC. Traveling's going to be tough, and their roster is not ready to win out there. Then there's Baylor, Dave Aranda and company. It feels a little aimless. What a tragic last season this was. Very surprised he got a second chance. Just seems like a recipe for failure. You've got Indiana with first-year coach Kurt Cignetti. It's going to take multiple years to put Indiana in a position to compete in the Big Ten. It's as simple as that. I believe in Kurt Cignetti. I think he can do it, but it's going to take time. You've got Vanderbilt, one of the most disappointing teams of this last season, in my opinion. They looked lifeless after showing some hope the year prior. And so for Clark Lee, this is a big make or breaker year. Even though he just got that big extension, I think that he's got to prove that the improvements aren't just going to be isolated one out of every 5 years. It's got to be consistent improvement from a doormat team. And then last is Mississippi State, a team trying to avoid becoming another Vanderbilt in the SEC. I feel like they're dangerously close to that. They were obviously the victim of a horrible situation with Mike Leach tragically passing away, Rip Pirate. And Zach Arnett wasn't the guy. So they're bringing in Jeff Levy, and we'll see what Levy can do. It's not something that hire that moves the needle a lot for me, but I think it's the home run swing that a team like Mississippi State has to make if they want to compete in the SEC. So for year one in Lebby, I think it could be a little rough, but that is it for the bad tier, and that is it for the Power 5 tier list. So there you have it. That is the 2024 Power 5 tier list made in late January, because I know how it is if you're a college football fan. This is going to change a lot. It's just going to continue to fluctuate throughout the year. So some people might think, why? Why even make one this early? I just know how it is. You're a college football fan and you're in January and you're scared and you haven't seen college football in nearly a month and you know that it's months out until you get anything again. And so you're just looking for something to cling on to. So if I was able to provide that for somebody today, that makes it all worth it. So I appreciate you guys for watching. And let me know down in the comments what you think about my tier list and what you would change. Thank you guys for watching another CF Budge YouTube video, 2024 Power 5 tier list. Pretty legit stuff. I'm pretty sure we're close to 1,000 subscribers. I think we're about to hit 900. I said we were going to hit 1,000 by February. We haven't hit that yet. Maybe this video can change that. Maybe this video can give us the boost we need. But if you like the content, you want to see more, let me know down in the comments some other video ideas that you can think of. And go ahead and like, comment, and subscribe if you enjoyed it and you want to see more. That's everything. So I will see you guys later.